Hello all. I'm speaking English because I understand that we have guests from all over the world. So thank you for joining us. We'll talk today about Agile for hardware and multidisciplinary systems, sorry. There's so much to say and discuss about Agile for hardware, and as I said, we have limited time, so I want to discuss a certain perspective. How hardware teams can support the agility of the organization and be part of the overall Agile process. However, at the end of the webinar, we'll have an open Q&A session through the chat, and you could ask me anything related to Agile hardware. By the way, in July, we are going to have full 2 days training. So for those of you who want to learn more, I will elaborate about this at the end of this session. A little bit about me, who I am. My name is Gili Aharoni. I'm an electrical and computer engineer. I've had roles starting with hardware and software development, manager of some large R&D units, manager of product management and business management, and also management of some companies or small enterprises. In the past few years, sharing my knowledge in management strategies and practices in my time, I delivered a lot of hardware and software to the market, and I've used almost any management practices to achieve that. I first heard about Agile some 15 years ago, and since then I'm passionate about how teams can do better and improve their processes. Okay, so I would like to start with a quick review of the basics. I see that some of the people have limited experience with Agile, so we'll start just a little bit with the basic. We'll not teach Agile concept today, but we will review it on a high level. When we talk about Agile, we talk first about values and mindset. When we drill down to what it means and how to implement it, we borrow values and principles and practices also from lean management and design thinking. This is because the three management philosophies are complementary. They have a lot in common, and they contribute to the wholeness of the right management mindset. Two perspectives to talk about. One perspective is how hardware team can work as part of the Agile organization. And the second one could be how hardware team work as an Agile team. Today we will discuss the first one. Usually we see that hardware teams do practice some of the concept of Lean Agile. But when going to scale, we see that it changes. For example, a software engineer may say, I finished coding, everything is ready. When coding is just written, but no test was done and is still not in production. With the hardware engineer, we usually understand that providing the OCAD diagram is just the first step, and he needs to do a lot more steps in order to deliver it to the market. But when the board is ready after debug, we usually put it aside and go on, continue with that. The problem with that is that it may lay on the shelf for a few months or a year until it will go to integration. It happens a lot with hardware because management take a lot of spare or buffer time in order to accommodate risk. But this is a kind of waste. First, if I'm ready with the hardware much before it is needed, then I could have done something else in that time. And if it is done and nobody is going to use it because it, for some reason things change in the market, then again, we are just waiting, wasted a lot of effort and money on developing this piece of hardware. What we want to do is do it in a different way that creates less waste and is more aligned with the needs of the market. Looking at the Agile manifesto, we see four sentences, value sentences, that are comprised of eight valuable things in software development. This was written by 17 people on the mountain in Utah, and since then, It was spread all over the world, but the fact is that this is not new. I mean, the management practices here were thought about long ago. It was just composed 15 years ago, something like that. It was composed into some coherent philosophy, management philosophy. And because it was written by software people, it was written in a software language. But the thing is that if we look at the sentences, we understand that when we talk about visual interactions or people and team and communication, it is obviously relevant to any team, not just software team. And when we talk about when working software, if we understand what's behind that, we understand that we're talking about a product or a value or a service or a software, a piece of software. And again, if this is the case, then it's relevant to any service or product. And when we talk about customer collaboration and we drill down about then the meaning, and we understand that whoever consumes my work is actually a customer of mine, then we need to do collaboration not just with the customer, but also internally, it's customer and collaboration. And if we look at the last one, which is the more challenging one, if we talk about the hardware, apparently it looks like a more challenging. It is responding to change is actually continuously optimizing for the goal. It means that, okay, if we have a plan, this is great, but this is just the start because the plan may need to change. The plan or the goal even may change with time because we learned something, understood something that we didn't understood before. It doesn't matter if I'm doing hardware or software, any type of mechanical design. If things change, I need to recheck my plan and maybe I need to change something there. And there are a lot of practices that can contribute to that. It can be by me planning to change. I mean, I'm doing some sort of design, and if I can assume that things may change. And the good practice is to plan for that, and in advance to build my piece of hardware in a way that it will be easy for me to change. It's not always possible, but if it is possible, it is a good practice. Or it could be that we want to make the changes more cost effective. Okay, I may need to change, and I want to make it cost effective. If not changing easily, then at least it should be cost effective to change. And I understand that change could be very expensive. Change could be something that is 10 times the initial estimation. Okay, so we need to take this into account, but still, if we need to change and the change has a good ROI, then we should. Some of the other practices could be leaving cost reduction to post-production, plan for optional cost reduction at the end, set by design, modularity, prototypes, mock-up, simulation. This is just some of the practices that allows you to optimize along the way what you do to adapt to the changing goal or the changing events. I won't go deep down into this slide because we don't have the time, and I want to go as fast as possible to the practices, but I do recommend you to read it and replace software with product or service or hardware and think what it means for you to practice this principle. And you will find that in many cases, or most cases, actually all cases, you can find ways to do that, just that, practicing these principles with your own domain. One thing that I want to mention, because we are going to talk a lot about value, is that value is not just delivering software. Value is anything that we learn from. Delivering software and getting the bucks is the ultimate value, of course, but learning something is also valuable. And when we see, when we think about what value is comprised of, as of course, the holy grail is the business with the customer, but also feedback from the customer and also feedback from internal stakeholders in the organization is also valuable, and reducing risk is also valuable, and enabling us to go faster is also valuable. So when we consider that, we understand that, for example, if I'm doing hardware and I find a way to make software people or help the software people go faster because I did something that allows them to start integration early, then we should do it. This is value. The lean mindset, I'm talking about lean agile, the lean mindset talks about lean leadership that supports four pillars, and together all of this aim to create value. And if we look, we will look at each of these pillars and talk about them in a minute, okay? Actually, when we talk about Lean Agile, we are talking about delivering value early and often, creating early and fast feedback loops, and seeking ways to continuously improve. We don't want the Big Bang phase approach where we do requirements, design, development, long integration, and only then we do testing. And sometimes we find that we miss the business or the customer is not happy with what we did. So the better way would be to work in some way incrementally and provide value incrementally. It's like fixing our course in real time, likewise. And we can do it today also with hardware. Here I'm showing a slide. Dragonfly LDM is a machine that can print multi-layer boards and provide you with the opportunity to do a new board overnight every day. This is agile. And agile requires investment. It requires investment in training. It requires investment in restructuring and understanding the flow of the value. And it requires also to apply some technical or technologies that can support the agility of the organization. So 3D printing in general is a great tool to support mechanical design. And here we can see that we can do 3D printing with electrical design, which is great for your agility. I mentioned before the flow value of lean product development or lean thinking. When we're talking about flow, we understand when we do development, we do a stream of activities that provide value. The stream of activities is done by many functions in the organization. Some of them are products, some of them are system analysis, electrical design, mechanical design, purchasing, software purchasing, assembly, production, QA, etc., etc. The thing is, we have silos. Each of these, if this product and business is disconnected from the system analysis and the electrical domain is disconnected from the software domain, then what we have is silos that work independently from each other, and the integration between them is done very late in the process. Remember the slide with the integration and QA at the end, where we see customer not happy at the end of the process? We don't want that. We want the integration to take place as early as possible. So the idea is to break the value chain, okay? And understand the value stream, break the value chain, and connect the silos together. This way we can remove waste from the this value stream of creating value. And there are some practices to do it. The best way is just having cross-functional teams, having the technical engineer and mechanical engineer and the software engineer and firmware engineer and everybody that contributes to the development value stream work together to achieve what we ought to achieve. The thing is that you may say that, okay, but this is not practical. How can we separate the domains and three or four firmer team people can may work a little bit less efficient than four people in a team of 14 people. But the practice shows that actually it's quite the opposite. Two teams, one of eight people, firmware teams, and one of six hardware people will work less effectively than two teams of four firmware and three hardware. Because this way, we break the silos, people work together, they help each other, and they work towards the same common goal, providing what they need to achieve much faster. Scaled Agile framework is a framework that scales Agile to more than one team. And what we actually have when we have a multidisciplinary solution, we have a team of teams. We have people who are doing mechanical design and people that are doing electronics and people that are doing software, et cetera, et cetera. And it's a team of teams. Scaled Agile framework is a methodology to scale Agile to such scenarios. I will not go into that, but we will look at it from the practices side just now. One practice to achieve that, to align all people to the same goal, is create a common vision. Once we have a common vision, we identify the main goal. We can do a lot of things together because we understand each other and what we need to achieve together. To achieve that, we practice big room plannings. We need to use some collaboration tools online and offline. We'll talk about some offline collaboration tools like Big Chart. But using these tools allows us to work continuously together towards the same goal. So creating a common vision and having a common goal is the first thing that we should do. Another practice is obviously storming together. Once we have this vision, storming together towards this business end is something that provides a lot of improvement opportunities. Remember this earlier example about this team who provided hardware and it went to the shelf because the software team wasn't ready to take it in and integrate. So we said it's a kind of waste. The hardware team could do something else in that time. So the better way would be to say, okay, we have now a common mission. We, the hardware team, we, the software team, we, the firmware team, need to work together in order to achieve that. Let's work together and plan together to achieve this goal. And we have several practices in order to support that. Probably you're already familiar with the concept of Scrum and program increment. Program increment is a kind of time box that allows us to increment the product functionality together in a time box bigger than one sprint. And when we deploy collaboration events like planning together, thinking together along this program increment and inspect and adapt on what we did in the last program increment, we create an area, we create an environment where we can storm together towards the same end. Another tool is visualization and synchronization. Some of the tools are big planning board, physical Kanban boards, big chart, using management Kanban, Kanban for the feature that we want to provide or the product that we want to provide, team Kanban, all sorts of Kanbans that can support the flow within each level in the organization can provide a lot of value. I've witnessed teams where they just implemented Kanban with a daily reviewing this Kanban every day. And this simple practice just created the tremendous boost in the productivity and alignment providing mechanical items with very little or no software at all, just mechanical devices that move doors and move stairways. And just by implementing Kanban, they achieved a lot of agility. Another practice is integrating early and often. And now you may say, okay, how can I integrate early and often with hardware electronic board? Okay, so it might be that you cannot integrate every couple of weeks. It could be, but it could be that you could. If you examine the opportunities to do that, you may find a lot of opportunities. But let's say that you're doing a board in 6 months and you improve it, and you're doing now in 3 months. This is agility. Doing something faster than you did before, this is a better agility. You are now more agile than before. And any opportunity of integration, any opportunity of providing deliverable items should be used. And this simple thing of integrating together as frequently as possible is very powerful. Examples of that? Let's say we need to provide a new hardware board for the new product that we need to develop. Now, it might take us several months to provide this board. So one thing is to optimize on having this board faster, but might not provide the best value. Think of that. There's a manufacturer of, let's say, airplanes that can provide one airplane per quarter. And there's a certain division in this plant that can provide wings, can provide 6 wings per quarter. How does that help the organization? It has no value. They don't need more than 2 wings every quarter. So the better way would be to do this 2 wings and then go and help the others to accelerate production and maybe provide the whole airplane in 2 months and not 3 months. And this kind of thing is looking for the opportunities to improve, and the flow is the thing that we need to look for. We talked about printing a hardware board in a multi-layered hardware board in a couple of hours. Okay, this is something that can be used. Maybe I don't need to build a big board. I can build a few small boards and integrate them together, provide the functionality needed by the software team, and then go and integrate it all to one more complex board. Maybe I can take another board and tweak it and provide it to the software team and let them start and integrate their software with this tweaked board, and then go and start developing the new board. So maybe providing the new board as fast as possible is not the best thing to do from the perspective of the big picture. And if we look at the big picture, we understand what we need to do, and we ask ourselves what can make us do it faster, we might find that optimizing on a certain domain like electronics is not the right thing to do. But optimizing on the bigger flow from start to end might provide better value. Maybe I can delay the production of the new board by 1 month, but provide an earlier prototype to make the whole process much more fast and provide the overall solution faster. Okay, I just skip that. Yeah, because there are many more opportunities to integrate and collaborate. It's not only providing a board, but collaborating on design, daily meetings, planning increments, design reviews, providing prototypes, hardware emulators for software design, 3D printing that we discussed, cross-disciplinary inspect and adapt, demos, parallel design activities, etc. All those things provide a lot of integration or learning integration that is also very important. So we talked about big room planning. It seems like that big room planning might be a kind of waste. What do you mean? Bring all the people from all domains together to plan together? But yes, because the information on what is needed is present with the engineers and QA people that are doing the work. And if we put them together and they talk together, they identify all the risk, all the integration points. They ask each other for certain ways of providing the or building the process and create the stream of events in a way that we have less risks and less dependencies that stops certain domains from incrementing or from developing the, or doing their thing. So joint planning sessions is a very nice practice that provides a lot of value in Lean Agile or in Lean Agile. Using design sprints, when we build mechanical devices, when we build solution, we may use many practices that emulate the even on the paper, okay? Even with cardboard, things that mock up and emulate the thing that we are doing or need to do, and check it months before the product is ready. We can understand concepts of mechanical design way before we actually have the actual product, just by mocking the design and having some kind of early learning cycle. And this can be done in a few matter of few hours or matter of few days. We can build the prototypes, test them, understand a lot of things that don't really need to wait for the actual product. Sometimes we learn things that if we didn't learn at the beginning, could not be achieved, or the learning could not be achieved at the end, or we learn but we won't be able to correct. Another nice practice when teams work together is to sync and use cadence. Cadence, if we talk about Scrum and sprints and program increments on a bigger scale, when people work on the same pace, on the same cadence, with the same heartbeat, they have deliverables and goals that they can put together and achieve more alignment between the teams. This simple practice of having a cadence for the development is very nice because it creates a lot of learning opportunities, and it creates a lot of this type of learning integration that we talked before. We talked about collaborating design thinking. I want, because we are almost out of time, I want to go to more practices. Creating value. We talked about creating value not only for the end customer, but creating value for anyone who is consuming the work that I do. We gave the example of the prototype that can be provided to the software team way before the product is ready for the integration. This is creating value for internal customer. The software team is consuming the deliverable of the hardware team. And if we find ways to create early value, early delivery for the software team, then we expedite. And we need to find those opportunities along the way. We need to work for that. It's not something that can be, will happen if we won't look for it. It's not something that will happen if we won't work, if we won't research. We need to work together in order to understand. The software team need to tell the hardware team that what they expect, so the hardware team will know what is the right thing to do. Here I have summarized some of the things that we talked about and some more small practices that can help us. So we talked about building cross-functional teams, putting teams together. This is the best thing to do. It's not always possible, but if it is possible to put the firmware, the hardware, the mechanical engineer, and everyone that can be is now working on the product together, and let them work together, storm together towards the same goal, we will have better and more focused organization, and we will have faster deliverables and less risks. Simulating, creating models, we talked about it, mockups, we talked about prototypes, hardware team providing emulators for the software team, a mechanical team that provides 3D printing early in the process for the hardware team to develop an experiment. Example could be cable design that may be done parallel to the hardware design, and this way we can put the cable in the packaging more securely. We can understand better the thermal design of the product just because we're doing it together. If we will build the board and later we'll provide the cables, we might find that the thermal flow, the flow of the air is building too much heat. So understanding that in real time, while the hardware electronic teams is working on the board, is much better. I mean, yes, do the cable design. Yes, do the thermal analysis. Yes, do the packaging design. Do all of it together. You will understand a lot of the problems early in the process, and you will eliminate a lot of problems that you find today. If you're working on a waterfall, with a waterfall process, you're finding a lot of issues at the end, hard to fix issues. This will help you do better. Defining interfaces early in the process. Interface locks a certain contract between two parties, and then it's easier to change things behind the curtain, because we know how we talk between us. We know it doesn't matter if it is software with software, or hardware with hardware, or cable with hardware. When we lock the interface, we understand the interface early in the process, and we can free the other team to do a better design. Set-based design is another practice where we defer decision and preserve options. What does it mean? When we need to decide on a certain solution, should I build this board, or should I buy this board? Maybe I should build a board and also look for a third party board and do it in parallel and decide later in the process. If I go just with planning my own board, okay, and I use a certain interface that nobody else is using, then when I get to the end and I find that I failed for some reason, I don't have another option. If I look at both options, I understand that I can build my board with the same interface as the third party board, then I can continue the process of evaluating the two solutions till the very last minute of the development. And then if I fail for some reason, I still have the option to take the other solution. Now, it could be that I'm developing two solutions in parallel, if we take it to this extreme. But the thing is that let's not lock ourselves with solutions early in the process. Let's understand the interfaces, just understand. The thing is locking definitions as late as possible. And then you leave options open as far as possible to the future. So this is just on a high level of how you could implement Agile in your organization where you have multidisciplinary domains. We looked here at the how it is done on the team of the teams, how the hardware team can support the organizational agility. We could also talk about how the hardware team work internally in an agile manner, but it requires more time than we have today. As I mentioned, if you want to learn more, we will have in July today's interactive training with collaboration and plenty of use cases and exercises. We discuss your own cases if you are willing to share it, and we'll cover concrete practices and principles and the mindset of the Agile for hardware. The agenda will be sent later this week. Now we are open to questions. If you have questions, let me look if you already put some questions here in the chat. What are the pitfalls when building cross-discipline teams, and how do technical leaders can affect these teams? Okay, nice. Yes. Okay. The thing is that obviously when we have a team of 10 hardware electrical engineers, they share a lot of knowledge. And this is obviously, it has its own benefits. When we build cross-functional teams, in a way we might feel that we lose that. But if we preserve, and we have ways to preserve the knowledge sharing between the electrical engineers, then we may end up with the benefits from both concepts. For example, we could keep the organization structure with the team of engineers, with the technical leader there. They can have their own learning sessions and their own sharing. But the thing is that the day-to-day should be spent as much as possible with the organic team, which should be the agile team, the cross-functional team, the team that is now working to deliver value together. And some other practices could be forums for all the electrical engineers in the organizations where they meet once every time and they work together. It could be that we'll have a small team of engineers that is working on electrical development practices and provide guidelines for the all the cross-functional teams. So there are a lot of practices that still allows us to share this knowledge. Okay. Another question here, where should we use Scrum or Kanban? Okay. Kanban is obviously the easiest and the most powerful team for mechanical teams and electronics teams. It's a practice that is aligned very nicely with the needs of such teams. But having the sprint events can provide a lot of value. So what we do, we use the two together. We call it Scrumban. And that way we benefit from the Kanban management, but we also have the opportunities to plan together, the opportunities to learn together, the opportunities to align in cadence. And this is my advice where I implement Agile or help with the Agile transformation. This is the best practice as far as I see it. How to tackle simultaneous development of several related products in cross-functional groups. Okay, this is exactly the thing. The thing is that the best thing is for a cross-functional team to work on one product. They take this product, this is their goal. They work together, they provide it, and then they go and take another product to develop. And if there is another team, they will work on another product. So two teams can work on separate products, or this team can work on several products in series and not in parallel. The thing that parallel, it looks like working in parallel provide more speed, but it's quite the opposite. We didn't have the time to try it, but we have some very nice exercises where we can show you that working in parallel will always be slower than working in series. Is it possible to avoid planning on a Gantt chart when working on a mechanical electrical product while using Agile? Okay. I think that It depends. What does it mean again? I think it's more a kind of roadmap of events or milestones. Okay, we need to understand what our milestones are, and we need to align to these milestones. But it's not exactly a Gantt. We need the milestones. We need to understand that, okay, there's something that need to happen. It's beyond our control, and it needs to happen, and we need to align this with this milestone. So having a Gantt is not the actual practice, but understanding what you need to do and where you have certain points that you need to refer you to and prepare for, this is something that must be done. An organization who uses Agile and continuously improving the product might find itself changing the hardware at a higher rate. How do we solve the process of the delivery product to production at a higher rate? This might create situations where the production engineer operations will not be able to handle such a change. Okay. Yeah, the question is clear. The thing is, we're not talking about necessarily providing a very fast product to the market, okay? We're talking about making changes fast during the process of development. I mean, we need to have an integration point as early as possible. We want to have a deliverable that we can test as early as possible. This is the thing, okay? And it needs to be internally first. And it could be that we can change the hardware only 1 year because whatever, okay? It could be. So if this is the guideline, if this is something that we need to comply with, then we will comply with it. But within this year, we don't want to do a big, we don't want to provide the actual product just at the end. We want to provide it by pieces, as early as possible, an increment until we have the final product. I hope this is understood. If not, just ping here. More questions? Ophir. Thank you, Ophir. Nice. Okay, guys, I hope you enjoyed it. I hope that you can take some advice from this session today. You're welcome to email and ask questions. And I hope that you will start your Agile journey today. Thank you. Have a nice evening.